not here to deny people a right. We're here to fix a wrong. They said it was over. Is it over? We're seeing something unprecedented in our island's history. We're putting aside our personal feelings about politics, our preference for a given political status, our differences in our place of birth, different languages, our differences in many ways, just to unite behind a single cause of tomorrow self-determination. We are the people of Guam who look out for each other, who respect each other, who understood that tomorrow hospitality and the Hafa Day spirit was not an invitation to deny fundamental right to choose a political future. We are not dividers. We are uniters. We're not seeking to fight with others. We are promoting peace. That's why we are here arm in arm, step by step, marching, walking in the full view of our ancestors who came before us and are this moment watching us. Maila, come with us. Fanohi, Kahulu, Kalamtin, move forward with one clear voice that will not be silenced, that will be heard here in Adaloop, over there in the federal courts, in Washington, D.C., in New York, wherever there are people who make decisions about us. They must hear the echoes of history, the cries for justice, the voices of the people who are gathered here this beautiful morning. Let them know that you are here. Are you ready? Biba Guahan! Biba Guahan! Nalagang louder, Biba Guahan!
I would now like to invite the Honorable Magahagan Guahan, Governor Lourdes Leon Guerrero, for opening remarks.
Mampus Dikikizu. Buenas den half a day, Sizus Masi Ken. Mlaguzu bel naiam zu todus un donkulu na sizus masi ni finatun mizu magi per at the discusta esti imas un tanti na inin alta motna. Mlaguzu be nai un donkulu na agradecimenti edzi se tautosan hizu ni man matugini per at tafen dana per tafen hita per at the discuta taru hafa mas malig na gubernamentu hit motnagi is lata. Persidus ma'asid za letku na hunggan gosmali kesti na konferensya sa para ta fan la malati pata fan la mas tiningo pur hafa pata tsogwi. Persidus ma'asid malagu zu be recognisa si Melvin Wampat Borja and itautanya ni muna posibli esti na okasyon. Persidus ma'asid Melvin. Buenas and half a day, everyone. Welcome to Guam and welcome to the Fanjita Conference. Fanjita in tomorrow means together, and in the context of this very important conference, it means let's come together. I want to recognize again the leaders from Australia, U.S. Virgin Islands, Puerto Rico, Hawaii, American Samoa, the CNMI, and of course, Palau, who have done just that. They came together to discuss this long-standing issue of self-governance and how to achieve it. It has been said that we are tomorrow's seafarers and our ancestors navigated their poas and their galides, and some made their homes along the Marianas chain of islands, especially in Guam and Sienamai. We lived then in a self-governing order until the invasion of the Spaniards, then the United States, then the Japanese, and then the return of the United States. In a nutshell, since 1695, we have been a non-self-governing island. This is my history as I know it. Our Chamorro culture is matrilineal, meaning it is based on relationship with the mother or the female line. Given that I am the first Mega Haga of Guam and that we have our first majority, super majority actually, of female legislatures, I believe that now is the time for the women of our respective governments to come together to join and push this issue of self-governance to the forefront. It was the Prime Minister. It was the Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher who said, "If you want something said, ask a man. If you want something done, ask a woman." Self-governance is the elusive pot of gold at the end of the rainbow for more than a dozen non-self-governing entities around the globe. Guam, the U.S. Virgin Islands, and American Samoa fall into this category. We are non-self-governing territories of the United States of America. Puerto Rico is now a commonwealth, and we thank the Puerto Ricans contingent for joining us today to share your experiences negotiating your status with the United States Congress and for sharing what Commonwealth status has actually meant for the people of Puerto Rico. Solidarity is essential for the people of non-self-governing entities like ours. We need to learn from the victories and we need to learn from the defeats that each of us has achieved or suffered in order to transform each of our self-governing efforts into reality. Alliances with each other will enable us to become stronger together and to stand up for each other when dealing with entities that are perceived to have much more power than we do. The issues that we face in this part of the world affect all of us. The military buildup on Guam will bring jobs to the region, to be sure. But it will also bring a host of challenges that will bring us, like how do we balance national security and defense with protection of our environment, our culture, our heritage, our land, our people, and our waters. Next year, in 2020, Compact of Free Association with the Federated States of the Micronesia is up for renegotiation. As a non-self-governing territory, in past negotiations, we have no say, yet decisions made greatly affects us in every aspect of our social and economic structure. I am asking our brothers and sisters from the FSM and Doug Dominich, the Assistant United States Secretary of Interior for Insular Affairs, to bring Guam to the table for these renegotiations. Because what happens in the FSM affects us here on Guam. In fact, all of our island entities are interconnected. If the issue of global warming has taught us anything, it is that there are very few areas of the world that are not somehow connected with other areas. We as human beings thrive on interconnectivity. It is how we negotiate, how we trade, how we help each other, and how we work out our differences. So for all of us at this Fajita table, these next 2 days, Let us strengthen our connections. Let us learn from each other, and let us put our heads together to strategize so that all of us who seek to break free from the reins of colonialism will finally triumph as self-governing peoples. Sijus Maasi, and welcome to the table.
In 2016, there was a case taken to the United States Supreme Court, and the name of the case is Sanchez Valle. And in that case, the question was whether if a person was accused by the same crime, both under Puerto Rico law and the U.S. law, whether that was a violation of the double jeopardy prohibition. And up to that 2016 case, the position was that Puerto Rico could accuse a person under Puerto Rican laws, and at the same time, the same person could be accused by the same crime under federal laws, because since Puerto Rico was supposedly an autonomy, there were two separate sovereigns. Well, the United States Supreme Court decided in the Sanchez Valle case that no, that we were not two sovereigns, that Puerto Rico did not in fact have any sovereignty, that Puerto Rico was an unincorporated territory of the United States, which was ruled under the Territorial Clause, and that the United States Congress could do whatever they wanted with the territory. The relationship with the United States is, in fact, and has always been, and has never ceased to be, a colony.
And now we will begin with our first panel, Gidenmanu Hitmagi, The Road We Have Traveled, a panel which will set the contextual frame of colonialism in Guam with Dr. Carlos Madrid, Professor of Micronesian Studies at the University of Guam, and Dr. Michael Lujan Bavacqua, Assistant Professor of Chamorro Studies at the University of Guam. Dr. Madrid will cover the Spanish era, and Dr. Bavacqua will cover the American era. Let's give a round of applause for our panel today.
Buenas and half a day, todos amu. Honorable Governor Julian Guerrero, Honorable Lieutenant Governor Joshua Tenorio, distinguished guests, friends, colleagues. It's my pleasure to be here today to provide a short, concise overview over the 333 years spanning the Spanish administration of the Mariana Islands, the capital of which was the island of Guam. This long changing period culminated with the Treaty of Paris between the United States of America and Spain after Spanish defeat in the war between the two countries. The sovereignty of the archipelago was claimed in 1565, and the Christianization of the inhabitants was followed by a series of violent confrontations, wars, a process of conquest that lasted over 20 years until the 1680s. The resistance of a good part of the indigenous population in the 1600s is a testimony that the control of the islands was acquired only after a strong resistance and by violent means. The war was followed by a period of epidemics that had devastating consequences and cost almost the population of the islands. The population did naturally change the political situation, the political stage. As far as the 1700s is concerned, the lack of political representation was common in the 1700s in Europe. So I'm gonna fast forward into the 1800s, in which we find the first Spanish constitution, the third in the Western world after the United States and France. The constitution of 1812, the first article declared that the Spanish nation was formed by the peoples of all over the world, of both hemispheres. So this included the indigenous peoples of all of the Spanish territories. Significantly, it excluded the Spanish of African descent, the Africans that were part of the Spanish territory. The next constitution was 1837, implemented again the political rights of representation of the Spanish Parliament, but it didn't take place the recognition of the political representations of the inhabitants of the Mariana Islands, the Philippines and the Mariana Islands. There was in fact one commission that declared specifically about the inhabitants of the Marianas what electoral law could accommodate a population scattered in various islands, most particularly the Marianas, 500 leagues from the Philippines, among them that of Guam, the only inhabited island, with 5,000 or 6,000 inhabitants, all of them, according to Article 29 of the Constitution, are Spanish. Do they have the right to be elected? What special law will be promulgated to let them exercise the political rights? Must they remain unaffected by the common law, considering the distance in which they find themselves? My point, ladies and gentlemen, on highlighting this sequence of events is that the problems that we're facing today are the same problems that have been faced for the last 200 years. So this is this political representation in the highest decision-making chamber of the nation. It has deep roots, and it's rooted in the lack of fulfillment of the promise of representation as embedded in the different constitutions that from the Constitution of the United States nowadays to the Constitution of 1812 in Spain. Next, the last real opportunity to receive political representation was in 1869, when in fact other territories like Cuba and Puerto Rico were granted rights of representation for the short period of time in which the Constitution of Spain was in place. But the Philippines was not to enjoy the same privilege, the Philippines and the Mariana Islands. There was a sentence that declared the regime which governs the Spanish provinces located in the Philippine archipelago, and that included the Marianas, will be provided by a special law, which eventually was not to happen. In fact, there's the 1873 Constitution of Spain during the First Spanish Republic that included an article that specifically designed to force the development of political institutions, public education, and human rights. That constitution was never implemented. A coup d'etat ended the democratic regime in Spain. And once again, the political representation of the inhabitants of the Mariana Islands was denied. It's in fact in this 1873, in the decades of the 1870s, that we find the most relevant office in Agaña in those times, and I will say for the 330 years of the Spanish presence, is the office of the governor of Agaña, which is the photo that we can see in the building, in the picture. Significantly, it was directly across the government palace, the seat of the colonial administration. It's a twist of fate, very interestingly, that the seal that we see on top presiding the building was found among the rubble of the destructions of World War II and is now placed in the very heart of the palace, which is the gardens, the chocolate house. So it's like the core of the self-governance of the Mariana Islands, symbolized by the nation in which they were taking part in the 1870s. It's now back in the place that it's soon to be the seat of the government of Guam. This unique colonial setting of Guam and the Mariana Islands, next, was such, it represents one of a kind. That's the office of the mayor was directly across the government palace. The office of the mayor had to be an indigenous person, and he was elected by general male suffrage every 3 years. So this creates a very unique political setting in which the demands of further political structures were not really necessary, given on number one, the autonomous realities that they were taking place in Guam at that time, and the inertia of the colonial administration that it served by the 1870s, no purpose whatsoever. Christianization had taken place and it was a priority of the government 200 years before. There was no commercial interest on the part of Spain that was devastated by a series of civil wars. So the lack of specific demands was unnecessary, but it doesn't mean that the confrontation with the colonial government didn't happen at every instance when there was an abuse or an exercise of power that it was not in compliance with the law. In fact, we can see it with 1884 with one of the Chamorro soldiers guarding the government palace shot the governor as he was entering, shot and killed him. This is the only time that it happened in the Spanish colonies in the Philippines and the Marianas during the 1800s. For sure, it has to be related to the fact that in the 1870s, in these years that I'm mentioning, there was hundreds of political dissenters, communists, anarchists, revolutionaries, socialists that had been deported to Guam, to Saipan, and to other islands of the archipelago. Again, it's not that the Chamorros were in need of any kind of epiphany to be told about you need this and this is what you can aspire for. If there's no a similar political movement like we find in the Philippines in the 1890s, the Katipunan, of revolutionary nature, is not for lack of demand or lack of national consciousness on the part of the Chamorros. On the contrary, is because given the inertia and the isolation of the territory, the fact that the Chamorro people have lived by their own means, self-sufficient for the last 200 years, and of course even before, no? But as far as the colonial administration is concerned, for the last 200 years, autonomous, self-sufficient, exercising their own religion, it meant that the only reason for confrontation was when the instances of abuses were taking place. And history shows us that they were certainly taking place. This unique reality of the colonial and reality of Guam and the Mariana Islands is represented by the fact that Agaña, the capital where 90% next of the population lived, was a city next since 1686. This is the birth certificate of the city of Agaña, the order declaring it a city. For those of us familiar with European setting, the fact that a population is given the right to be called a city, it implies self-governance, it implies a cabildo, a city hall. The election of an authority to rule the city. So that, and of course, who lives in the city, what is the population living in the city, the citizens, eventually. It's the byproduct of this type of colonization. Out of a ciudad, there's ciudadanía as a byproduct. This national identity, it's a clear evidence of the political identity of the Chamorro people in the 1800s. Next. This was gonna change in 1898. There's a sequence of events, the war for Cuba, Puerto Rico, Philippines. This is specifically a photograph of the bombing of Puerto Rico. Now, it's quite interesting to see if we do dissect what was taking place in 1898 during the peace negotiations between Spain and the United States, we see two facts. By the time on August 13, the protocol of peace between the two countries is signed, that protocol included that Spain will give up the sovereignty of Cuba. But at that time, Puerto Rico had not been taken over, and the Philippines had not been taken over. It was just Manila. So that Article 2 of the Protocol of August was saying Puerto Rico and other Spanish islands of the West Indies and the island of and one island of the Ladrones to be selected by the United States shall be ceded to the latter. So Puerto Rico and one island of the Ladrones, in the Spanish were known as the Marianas in 1668, one island to be chosen will be ceded. Would be given. It's not the right of conquest. Puerto Rico had not been, and our Puerto Rican friends will know this by the time is the negotiations are taking place. The military process of occupying Puerto Rico had not ended. In the Philippines, will not end until December. So what the protocol is foreseeing is a request that is not based on military conquest. Guam had been taken by the Charleston only in the figure of the military representatives. But the military authority of the US had failed to capture all the representatives of the Spanish government in the island. So the second person in command, legally, was forced to take over the government. And that was the administrator of public funds, Jose Sixto, who exercised his duty and took control again for the Spanish government of the island. Such as the nature of this exercise, that the following visiting US Navy ship acknowledged and recognized the sovereignty and the control of this interim governor. Recognize it also in the understanding that in Paris they were taking negotiations about, they clearly knew what was going to happen. My point is, next, is that what we saw in the Protocol of Washington is that there was a demand that it was not based on military conquest. In this interim of vacuum of power, one local authority of Guam, one of the intelligentsia members, Father Jose Palomo, knowing that, by this time, by the second half of 1898, nobody could foresee that the United States was going to take Colombia. Nobody, including the United States, including McKinley. The fact that they were taken, we can see, is a twist of the nature of the principles of the Republic. As Mark Twain said, as most of the advanced intellectuals of the United States reiterated, repeated over and over. So when Father Palomo issued a document with other members of the ruling class of Agaña stating, since the Spanish authorities have been removed, the local authorities have to take over the same way it has happened in Cuba and in Puerto Rico. And this is not because he was asking for U.S. taking over, but he was asking for, as it happened in other places, as it happened in the Philippines, for the protection of the United States and eventually for the self-governance that it was to be expected. I know I have other speakers after me, but just to mention that the lack of citizenship, the absence of a citizenship given in the Treaty of Paris, was one of the most heated debates of those weeks in Paris that were taking place until December 10th. The Spanish, on November 22, were given an ultimatum by the United States representatives saying, either you sign or we continue war. The Spanish were forced to sign, but wrote a public memorandum of protest expressing, among other things, that the inhabitants of the territories that Spain was forced to cede were not given the right to choose their citizenship. Next photo. Next. The bombing of Puerto Rico. Next. Next. The Treaty of Paris, the Article 9, our friends from Puerto Rico are very familiar with this. It says that the Spanish subjects residing in the territory over which Spain at the present relinquishes sovereignty will remain in such territory, so on and so. The Spanish subjects, that article was forced to include a sentence to say the Spanish subjects, natives of the peninsula. It technically excluded all of the indigenous populations, because until then, all of the indigenous populations were the Spanish subjects. Next. And next. That memorandum of protest of the Spanish representatives was contested by the representatives of the United States with another memorandum expressing that even though Article 9 will include that paragraph, the civil rights and political status of the native inhabitants of the territories hereby ceded to the United States shall be determined by Congress, an article that caused a scandal at the time, and as military lawyer Gonzalez Bernard commented, a demand as brutal as this was never witnessed by history, because native or adopted citizenship, it's a right, it's not an imposition. So the Article 9 included that paragraph that excluded citizenship, the right of citizenship, to choose citizenship for those territories that were ceded. And then what my colleague and friend Miguel Bobaco is going to expose is what came later on. All in all, before I finish, we can see that out of the 300 years of Spanish administration of the Mariana Islands, there was not a single instance in which the inhabitants could freely express their consent to be governed, and in what manner to be governed. And it's not in times in which there was no political representation. It was in times in which there were constitutions, there were debate about how to implement it, why to implement it, and the frustration of that exercise, it's, as I mentioned at the beginning of my presentation, evidence of the long-lasting problem that you are here to discuss today. To use mass, muchas gracias.
Today, todo Samzu. So, waiting for my PowerPoint to go up. And so, I will be talking about 1898 to 2019. And there's a lot of things that I'm going to talk about. Some of you may be, pictures of some of you may be in my PowerPoint, by the way, or pictures of your parents or your grandparents. Because that's always one of the things I want to impress upon you, is that it is common in places that are colonies, that whenever there is a movement or an uprising around decolonization or status change, to interpret it as always being new. It's not, it doesn't have any roots. It's not born from anything. It's a new thing. It may be from a lack of disrespect from the current generation. It may be from a lack of knowledge, a lack of worldliness. But what I want to impress upon in my presentation is that the push for self-governance and decolonization has traced back to the moment of colonization, and it has continued. Whenever there is colonization, there are always pushes for decolonization. And so we should always remember that for our own history as well. And so I'm going to give you a brief history of decolonization in Guam over the past century or so. And so, John, every time I say John, just click the slide. John, no, okay. Let's start off here. Okay, this is the Governor of Guam annual report from 1904. The Chamorro people are poor, ignorant, very dirty in their habits, but gentle and very religious. They lead lives of Arcadian simplicity and freedom from ambition or the desire for change or progress. They are like children, easily controlled and readily influenced by example, good or bad. This could be the next Chamorro t-shirt design, you guys. You could put this on your t-shirts. So this is, I bring this in to give you a sense of the colonial sort of thinking on the Chamorro people. This was reiterated during the Spanish time through the American period. We hear it today by callers into radio stations, comments on Facebook. There are arguments that the people are not ready, the people don't know what they're doing, that the people are ignorant. And so I had lots to choose from in terms of giving a good quote. My second favorite choice was from a governor's report about 13 years later, in which it said, "The natives are good at baseball, they're very good at stealing." Because the Ladron Islands, that's Navy governor humor, I guess. Okay, John. The Charleston, the taking of Guam in 1898. As my colleague Carlos has already mentioned, there was a lot of uncertainty about what was going to happen next. But there was some hope. Certain people on island were familiar with the United States. Padre Palomo, the first ever Chamorro priest in particular, was very familiar with sort of the rules and the government of the United States. And there was hope that the changing of the flags would mean more opportunities for the people of Guam. John. And so there was this rhetoric of American greatness, that America was spreading civilizing ideas, America similar to their father country, the British, that they were going into sort of the Philippines, into the Caribbean, and they were going to educate the people, civilize them, and so on. But what the Chamorro people in Guam soon realized was that there was limits to that rhetoric. The reality, John, was very, very different. And so if you're familiar with cartoons from that time about the United States using Uncle Sam, they don't make Uncle Sam look very good. They don't age well. And so there's Uncle Sam. He's got all of his different little colonial possessions in the front there. And the Native American, there's a Native American child sitting outside. And the idea is that Uncle Sam, because of these new possessions with inferior peoples in them, is saddled with this. And all of the white children who are sitting behind them that represents the states will not be taken care of because of all these new sort of inferior peoples that are coming into the US as part of the War of 1898. And so the reality of American colonialism was very, very different. The United States came in, planted their flag, and did not allow any of the democratic freedoms of which they sort of trademark and which they love to boast about, did not allow any of those things to exist in Guam. They created a military government, which was, for the most part, passive, ineffective, but did pinpoint certain things about the island that they wanted to change, that they wanted to get rid of, and had some effectiveness in that. So if you've ever wondered why we are speaking English here today and why the majority of people on Guam cannot speak Chamorro, a lot of it has its roots in that time, in that the naval government pinpointed the Chamorro language as one of the things that they wanted to get rid of.
gone. Now, Chamorros knew this. They knew very well, and this is important, because a lot of times we might say that our ancestors didn't know what was going on. They weren't familiar with things. They didn't know enough about the world to protest or to speak out. But as the 1901 petition that was signed by 32 people in Hagatnya shows, Chamorros knew exactly what the United States was doing. They call out the government that the United States had created as being a military government, and which is distasteful and highly repugnant and is particularly hypocritical to the ideals the U.S. is supposed to espouse. They also, interestingly enough, recognized that under the Spanish, regardless of what America argued about them being the bastion of freedom and democracy, under the Spanish they actually had more rights than under the American flag when it came in 1898. And so from day one, Chamorros send off a petition to the U.S. Congress saying, give us rights, give us political protections. Sometimes it's argued as citizenship, but ever since the moment the Americans arrived, there was always this critique. And that critique is important. John. These petitions largely don't do anything. There are some naval governors that are sympathize with the Chamorro people, do certain things to advocate for them. Most of the governors don't care. Sort of their Guam is not a choice post at that time, and a lot of them are just running out the clock until they can leave. Now, there is a huge spike in the 30s when there is a movement in the Philippines for independence, and there's an opening for Guam to possibly be considered for a change in status as well. People on Guam fundraise, and they send two representatives, B.J. Berdaliu and F.B. Leon Guerrero, to Washington, D.C. They meet with congressmen, they meet with senators, they meet with all sorts of people, they make a bunch of friends. They even have a meeting with Franklin Delano Roosevelt, in which there's different accounts about what happened, but all the accounts agree that Franklin Delano Roosevelt preferred to talk about fish and fishing as opposed to the political rights of the Chamorro people. And so FBLG, to his credit, tried to get FDR to visit Guam and tried to tell him a bunch of big fish stories to get him interested so that he could come to Guam. They were not successful. And one of the reasons they were not successful is, now that's a big bunch of text right there. You don't have to read that, it's bad. This is the Navy's perspective on Chamorro political rights. The Navy said, number one, the people in Guam, they're like children. You don't want to give them too much when they're growing. They said the Chamorro people are basically the most privileged people in the world because we do everything for them. They also argued, and interestingly enough, when FDR met B.J. Berdaliu and FBLG, he had previously written these statements against Chamorro rights when he was the Secretary of the Navy. And so the Navy basically shut down all of those things. And on the edge of the conversation was always something that we deal with up until today, the strategic nature of Guam's relationship to the United States. Was that rights for the people in Guam could conflict with the Navy's ability to carry out its mission, whatever that mission may be. Next. So there was no change. Despite many petitions, some of them signed by thousands of people. Some of those petitions were even signed by one in every four people on the island of Guam. Nothing happened before World War II. World War II doesn't change much the status politically of Chamorros in relationship to the United States, but it does change the sense of Chamorro identity after that. And so one of the things that we should consider here is that for the majority of the Chamorro people, regardless of how we see ourselves today, for the majority of the Chamorro people before World War II, if the United States took down its flag and left the island, Chamorros would have gone on with their lives. They didn't necessarily care. They didn't see their identity as connected to the American flag. They had their ranches, they had their farms, they had their families, they had their tsakmas, they had all of their stuff that kept them busy, and so they were good, they were happy. The war changes that. After World War II, suddenly the Chamorro sense of identity is strongly connected to that flag. And so that if that flag is not flying over the island, people are worried that things won't function. People are worried that people will attack the island. People are worried that we will descend into chaos if that flag is not flying over the island. And so that is one of the changes that comes out of World War II. It's not a political change, but it's a sense of identity. Chamorros become attached in sort of an imagined nation sense to the United States. Now, what was interesting is that the gratitude that Chamorros felt for the U.S. return and kicking out the Japanese, it spurred on those feelings, right? Chamorros felt an intimacy to the U.S. that they hadn't felt before, but that intimacy was immediately sort of challenged. New Chamorro feelings of patriotism were challenged because of the post-war land takings. And so on the right there, we have Tumon Bay. Tumon Bay was kind of one of the most sort of tragic sites in terms of the land taking, but thousands of Chamorro families lost their lands at that time. Some for very little compensation, some families protested, but the picture on the left there is a woman receiving the compensation for her land. You can see the admiral there smiling, saying, "We're taking care of the natives on the island." And you can see that woman saying, "Lanya, lanya chongi asti, atenesti na tauta ayade." I'm assuming. In the archives, there's no caption with that exactly on it, but I'm assuming that she is not happy. But so this leads to this sort of complicates things, because Chamorros are ready to believe in the United States, because the idea that that the U.S. represents freedom, they connect that to their war experiences. They were very unfree under the Japanese, and now when the U.S. returns, they expect to live like other Americans do because they were loyal. John. But the land takings and other things showed that this was not the case. Chamorros were not necessarily treated any better. One sign of that is because when Chamorros demanded political rights before the war, the Navy had given them the Guam Congress, which was an advisory body that had no power, but you could dress in your nice suits, and you could sit, and you could pretend you're a legislature, but you couldn't do anything except you could send a letter to the governor. That's all you could do. After the war, the Navy instituted the Guam Congress again, with two houses again, and Chamorros were not satisfied because you didn't have any power. You got to meet in Quonset huts with little fans going over your head in your nice suits, but you couldn't do anything. And so Carlos Taitano, there was a consensus at that time that patriotism wasn't it. So they had proved their loyalty, but it hadn't changed the relationship to the United States. So there was this idea about citizenship. So Carlos Taitano, in sort of the deliberations over what to do in response to the land takings and other issues involving the Navy, Carlos Taitano said, "We are outside the family now. How can we demand our rights if we do not belong? We have not the right until we have been granted citizenship. After you belong, then you can demand your rights." So there was this idea that if Chamorros received citizenship, then they would be respected by the United States. Then they would be treated fairly. The Guam Congress walkout ensued. These are some newspaper headlines from around the world. This was an early Guam viral moment, heavily shared on Facebook. This moment was Navy action protested by Guam Assembly, Guam's Boston Tea Party. That's exciting. Although some of the members in that walkout were a little bit, you know, it got a lot of attention because there was allies in the United States who were trying to get the Navy out of control for Guam and get another part of the federal government put in place instead. But really, the Guam Congress walkout was they walked out of a building. But it received enough attention, and there was this idea of Chamorros as sacrificing during the war and being treated so badly. And so it did get a lot of attention. For a lot of reasons, including the protests on Guam, the Organic Act was passed. Now, Carlos Taitano is there, and he looks very nice in that suit, by the way. He is the most handsome person in that room, clearly. Carlos Taitano back there. Interestingly enough, if you want to know how important Guam was in the signing of the Guam Organic Act, because some people say it's an important document that reflects the will of the people and so on, no one from Guam was invited there. Carlos Taitano happened to be going to college in Washington, D.C., and showed up. So the only reason there is somebody from Guam there is because he happened to be there and they let him into the picture. So if you wonder why we don't have a big Organic Act Day celebration, it's because it's not that exciting. It's like when, anyways. So what is the Organic Act? The Organic Act, a lot of different things, and we have to remember that the form it is in 1950 has been changed. And so in 1950, so it creates the government of Guam. It gives citizenship to people taken people who are descended from those who were there in 1898 and their descendants. It also gives birthright citizenship for those born on Guam. It allows for a locally elected legislature, a local judiciary. One of the big changes, though, is that initially the governor was not elected. And so when people talk about sort of the structure of the government of Guam, the U.S. made it in a certain way so that the governor is particularly powerful because the governor was appointed by the president until 1970. And so it also is a means through which parts of the U.S. Constitution apply to people on Guam. And so it is important that we not think of the Organic Act as a constitution. And we don't think of it as something similar to a constitution. It is an act of Congress. It is edited and it is changed by Congress. And Guam can request changes, but Guam doesn't have the ability to affect it itself. And so any idea that this is a document dealing with self-governance doesn't really make any sense when you think about it. Next. The late Ricky Berdalio, late in his life, he came to this assessment of the Organic Act, that it was actually a sad day for the people of Guam when it was signed, because it didn't enhance the dignity of the indigenous people. It instead enhanced the colonial authority of the United States. And that's something that we should think about, is that the fact that we benefited, or people benefited from it, does not mean it did not enhance the colonial authority of the United States. Done. So, Guam has this new status, but there's all these problems. Because what people on Guam realize, especially those who are leading the island, what they realize is that just because you're U.S. citizen doesn't mean the U.S. respects you or cares about you or takes you seriously. Because you're a territory. And so the first Constitutional Convention, and then if you look there on the left, oh, look at those. Those are some. There's former Governor Ada, the late Frank Lujan, my uncle David Flores. There's the late Tony Palomo. And I think, is that Dano? Is that Adrian Sanchez on the left? And so they were all part of the first Constitutional Convention. And if you want to kind of understand the complexities and the confusion around our status, the Constitutional Convention was not even sure if they were allowed to have a Constitutional Convention. They debated, are we allowed to meet? Are we allowed to do anything? And the consensus at the end of it was that they could not do it. So they just came up with a list of recommendations to change the Organic Act, because they felt we're a territory. We don't have the ability to actually create a constitution. And so, John, but that discussion in itself was important because it was connecting to other things in the world, including around Micronesia, was that Guam was a colony in an age of decolonization. Was that there was people around the world, including from small islands and small countries, who were getting a chance to think about their future, and Guam was excluded from all of that. Guam wasn't getting to sit at the table with the U.S. and talk about its political future. Guam wasn't getting to sit with representatives of the Queen and talk about their political future. Guam wasn't getting to talk to its colonizer at all, the way that people in Africa and in other places, the Caribbean and the Pacific, were. And so this pushed Guam to think, we need a better deal. Everyone else is getting a better deal, but we are stuck in this sort of archaic, we're stuck in this old, antiquated status. John. Now, the second Constitutional Convention happens. And there's, who is that? That's Tony Wampad, there's Carl Gutierrez, and there's Ricky Berdalio, oh, and there's President Carter. So the second Constitutional Convention was enabled by Congress. So Congress passed legislation. There's some debate over why it happened. Most likely from the federal perspective, it happened because they wanted to take Guam off the list of the non-self-governing territories. By allowing Guam to pass a constitution, they could say they're on the path to self-governance, and then they could get away from UN oversight on the issue. Now, the constitution was voted down, however. It was not successful. In fact, it was voted down by a huge margin. And one of the main reasons, there's actually several reasons, but one of the main reasons that it was voted down was because it couldn't address any of the fundamental questions about the relationship between Guam and the United States. And it couldn't do anything to address the hopes and the fears that people on Guam had about their future. If you think about a constitution, if you think about the Palawan constitution has elements which are about their fear of nuclear weapons, about nuclear-powered vessels. It ends up in the constitution to express the will of the people. If you think about the American constitution follows the same pattern. Values come out in the constitution. Ideas about the world, ways of protecting yourself, come out in the constitution. The Guam constitution, as enabled by Congress, didn't allow you to do any of those things. I always tell people nowadays, because somebody told me once, you should pass a constitution to protect cockfighting. Well, if you follow the enabling legislation, the constitution of Guam is not allowed to conflict with any federal law or mandate. Which means, oh, and the Virgin Islands, of course, knows this very well. Which means that you can't use it to protect something which the United States doesn't think should be protected. You can't use it to define something that the United States doesn't want to define. And so the consensus coming out of this was that status should be dealt with first, was that Guam should pick a status first, and then the Constitution can come later. Done. Around this time, this is also when the first Chamorros go to the United Nations to testify on behalf of Guam in the capacity, in its sort of oversight role. There's Ron Tehan, Chris Perez Howard, and Robert Underwood. And so this is the first of many who have gone, and in fact, many of the people in this room have been to the United Nations and testified. But this was sort of one of the first moments of international engagement around the issue. John. So, Commonwealth. After a series of votes, Commonwealth is the status that was chosen by the majority of people. Now, these plebiscites were open to everybody, and they didn't have very high turnout. But Commonwealth was sort of a best of both worlds, or a have your cake and eat it too type scenario. So what was Commonwealth supposed to do, John? So these are some of the elements involved in Commonwealth. Mutual, and this was something that was negotiated over many years between Guam and the federal government. Mutual consent. And when you look at this list, you can think about many of these are the way that we feel that we are unique in the world. The way that we feel that we are different from those who live in the United States and therefore should have particular powers in order to pursue advantages or to protect from problems. Mutual consent was one of those. The idea that Guam should have the ability to say no to a federal law which does not take Guam's interests into account. Local authority over things like immigration, labor laws, and the EEZ. The leaders definitely wanted the ability to work directly with our Asian neighbors, that to be able to sit at the table and to come up with aid programs, sort of tourism packages, all sorts of stuff like that. They wanted to have that flexibility. Also, limiting military power was one thing too. Getting excess lands returned, and also keen in their minds was the land takings after World War II, preventing the federal government from being able to use eminent domain again in Guam. And finally, Chamorro self-determination. This was one aspect of the negotiations, making it so that you could put into practice something like a land trust or programs for the indigenous people, and also it also defined ways in which the indigenous people could vote on things, could vote on the ultimate status for the island. Done. So Commonwealth didn't go anywhere. It had a long run, about 15 years or so, and then eventually there was a hearing in Congress, which was kind of the height of it, and then it died. The bill that was introduced, and it was introduced multiple times by different delegates, it eventually died. And when you see the list that I showed you for what Commonwealth was, you can kind of understand why it might be difficult to take it further in the federal government. A lot of states might like to have mutual consent, where they can say, we don't want this federal law to apply to us. A lot of states might feel that they should be able to control their own immigration. And so the U.S. sort of didn't decide it because of Guam, but they decided it in many ways for their own issues involving their own union. And so this led Guam to go in a different direction. John. And so there had previously been the Commission on Self-Determination, and I know that one head of it is here. I don't know, is Simon Sanchez here too? I thought he said he was coming. But so on the left you have members of the Commission on Self-Determination in Washington, D.C. But once the Commonwealth sort of push ended, there was a transition to the Commission on Decolonization. The agencies were around together for a while, and then eventually one phased out. And so the Commission on Decolonization had a slightly different sort of mandate. And it was one, so Commonwealth had been very much directed at the U.S. and negotiating with the U.S. and finding a status within the U.S., whereas the Commission on Decolonization opens it up more by following sort of the recommendations of the United Nations for the three status options. Done. Integration with the United States, statehood, free association with the United States, or independence. And so it was an attempt to restart the process, to have a plebiscite again, to figure out which direction they would go. John, but for many years there was delays over the issue. Under Gutierrez, there was supposed to be a plebiscite, but it was pushed back. Under Governor Calvo, there was calls to have plebiscites again, but nothing came from it. And so part of the issue then is having that first step of holding a plebiscite to determine what happens next. Last week, there was a big march in support of Chamorro self-determination. Over 2,000 people came and marched, and many of you were there. It's like a reunion. It's like we're having a Fanogi reunion, you guys. Wow. Okay. Anyways, but yes. So this conference is part of sort of the exciting place where we are now. And so thank you for your time, and thank you for your... Sidus Masi.